In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. It's good to be with you this evening. Someone commented that I have a liturgically correct color mask, and I didn't even think about that. So, my name is Father Jason Kern. I'm the vocations director for the diocese. I've been here before, so you've had to deal with me in the past, but it's good to be back and celebrate the weekend masses here in Fairmont and East Chain. So give thanks to God on this weekend. The Lord's going to challenge us, as He always does. He invites us to give everything. He says that if you find the pearl of great price, you must sell everything and buy it. If you find the treasure in the field, you must go sell everything you have and buy that field. And so we have to ask for the grace to give everything to the Lord tonight. But first we do that by acknowledging our sins. We acknowledge our own weakness, our inability to do so without His grace. So brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you are mighty God and Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you are Son of God and Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you are Word made flesh and splendor of the Father. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, protector of those who hope in you, without whom nothing has firm foundation, nothing is holy, bestow in abundance your mercy upon us, and grant that with you as our ruler and guide, we may use the good things that pass in such a way as to hold fast, even now, to those that ever endure. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the first book of Kings. The Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream at night. God said, "Ask something of me, and I will give it to you." Solomon answered, "O Lord, my God, you have made me your servant, king to succeed my father David. I am a mere youth, not knowing at all how to act. I serve you in the midst of people whom you have chosen, a people so vast that it cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding heart to judge your people and to distinguish right from wrong. For who is able to govern this vast people of yours?" The Lord was pleased that Solomon made this request. So God said to him, "Because you have asked for this, not for a long life for yourself, nor for riches, nor for the life of your enemies, but for understanding so that you may know what is right, I do as you requested. I give you a heart so wise and understanding that there has never been anyone like you up to now, and after you there will come no one equal to you." The word of the Lord. Lord, I love your commands. Lord, I love your commands. I have said, O Lord, that my part is to keep your words. The law of your mouth is to me more precious than thousands of gold and silver pieces. Lord, I love your commands. Let your kindness comfort me, according to your promise to your servants. Let your compassion come to me, and I may live, for your law is my delight. Lord, I love your commands. For I love your commands more than gold, however fine. For in all your precepts I go forward. Every false way I hate. Lord, I love your commands. Wonderful are your decrees, therefore I observe them. The revelation of your words shed light, giving understanding to the simple. Lord, I love your commands. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, we know that all things work for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, so that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure buried in a field, which a person finds and hides again, and out of joy goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant searching for fine pearls. When he finds a pearl of great price, he goes and sells all that he has and buys it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net thrown into the sea, which collects fish of every kind. When it is full, they haul it ashore and sit down to put what is good into buckets. What is bad, they throw away. Thus it will be at the end of the age. The angels will go out and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Do you understand all these things? They answered, yes. And he replied, then every scribe who has been instructed in the kingdom of heaven is like the head of a household who brings from his storeroom both the new and the old. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you. Well, are we doing okay? I hope so. I can't see your smiles. You know, it's crazy times. I think it's important for us to reflect at a deeper level, though, about the mysteries of all that's taking place in the mind and heart of God in the midst of our circumstances and our days. Now, certainly we'll never get to all of it. We'd be here a long time if I tried. But we can certainly reflect a little bit more about our own hearts and what we can do to respond to God in this time. The gospel challenges us today. The gospel challenges us to sell everything we have for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. In other words, it's saying, keep your end in mind. Keep the kingdom of heaven as your ultimate goal. Live for heaven. Don't buy up treasures in this world, but live for heaven. Okay, sounds good, God. Check, right? That's what I want to do. That's why I'm here. We're worshiping you. We want to put you first in our lives, right? We pray that that's true for all of us. But if it's not, we can pray for that grace to make it more true. Lord, free me from the things that prevent me from living for your kingdom. Free me from living for the things of this world. Free me from false ideologies that don't allow me the freedom to live for you alone. The things in my life that I've put before you or allowed to sneak in. The things in my life that have gotten in the way of living for the kingdom of heaven. Whether it's material goods or ideals. Things that I let kind of get into my mind that prevent me from really living for God. The first reading today is about Solomon, the wisdom of Solomon. We hear that phrase. Have you ever heard that phrase? We ought to have the wisdom of Solomon. Well, where does that come from? This reading. God says, I'll give you anything you want. You're a faithful son, right? Basically, that's my summary version of what he said. And he says, I want wisdom to govern your people. I think we'd all benefit from a few politicians who would pray that way, right? Not a political statement, but a little bit maybe, right? And this is the wisdom. Solomon's praying for the wisdom to lead and to know what's right and what is wrong, what is good and what is evil. How much do you and I need the wisdom to know what is right and what is wrong, what is good and what is evil today? What to be upset about and what not to be upset about? What to politicize and what not to politicize? What to fight over and what not to fight over? This is urgent today. And then the second reading, if those aren't enough for us to reflect on, the second reading today says, all things work for the good for those who love God. How much do you need to hear that? How much do I need to hear that? In these craziest of days as we look around the world and wonder what's happening or where we're going and what's going to come about. Maybe you don't think it's that crazy. Maybe you're like, my life's fine. I'm doing good. I got my family. But we still need to know how much God wants to work for the good in our lives. How much good he wants to do in us and through us through our willingness to love and serve his kingdom. How much he desires us to sell, not physically everything we have, but spiritually everything we have, psychologically everything we have in this world. We ought to lay it down and say, Jesus, I trust in you for my life. Some are called to give up everything. Some are called to sell all their possessions, but all are called to give everything. Spiritually, psychologically, emotionally. We're called to love and serve God first and to continue to say yes to that each day, to continue to say yes to that right now in our hearts as we love him and serve him and honor him. I want to reflect just briefly on the two ways that I think we get caught in the current Christian climate about how we don't love God, how we don't serve him, how the wisdom of the ages creeps into our hearts. rather than the wisdom of God. How we don't realize God is at work in every circumstance and every trial. Those three kind of themes from the readings today. And the first is this. All of us know that we're called to love God and love neighbor, right? Like, duh, Father, you're just saying the same thing that everybody says. We're all called to love God and neighbor. What prevents you from doing it then? What prevents Fairmont from filling up the churches, not just now, but all the time? What prevents people from flocking to Jesus? Well, our witness to love isn't great enough. Our witness to the love of Jesus Christ isn't great enough. We're good people. We're kind to one another. We don't curse God and neighbor. But we don't love the way that Jesus loves. We don't sacrifice the way that he sacrificed and really call people to the greater life of holiness and love that he has. See, we have set the bar at a kind of a place of Minnesota nice, which really means passive-aggressive, but whatever, right? We've set the bar at a low level of love. Just basically get along, and then you'll be fine. That's our mindset of love your neighbor. That's not the mindset of God. The mindset of God is a radical lay down your life out of love. Now, I know we can't do that perfectly all the time, and there's a lot of stuff going on, and right, okay. We can always make excuses, though. So to recommit ourselves to love as Jesus does. So first that, just to say it generally that way. Where is God asking you to love greater, to love more generously, to love more freely, with a heart that is filled with his charity, the charity of God towards neighbor, towards God? Do we love the way that God calls us to worship him and love him every day of our lives? I know I don't, and I need to beg God for more, to sell everything again, Lord. Give me the courage and understanding of how you're calling me to that. But here's the second point I want to make. So don't doze off now. Right? Because I think this one's even more important. This one's even more important. Because we all know this, the love God part. But the second one is, how do we learn to be conformed to his truth in a culture where there's so much confusion, in a culture where there's so many ideologies forced upon us, right? To be conformed to his love, but also conformed to his truth. These are the two dichotomies, right? That we kind of hold against each other, right? Oh, Father's harsh. Father's cold because he believes in truth. No, like, the church has always held that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. The way of love, the way of mercy, the way of freedom from sin and death to eternal life. But the truth will set you free, scriptures tell us, and the life to eternity. But what is his truth? Well, these are the teachings of the church. These are the teachings that God has held on and given us through his church, the one holy Catholic apostolic church that you and I profess in the creed. And this is the hard part, because even if you do believe, that you believe in the church, you believe in the teachings of Jesus, what happens? The world puts pressure on you to believe their truth. The world puts pressure on you to think in the ways of the world, right? And this is the fact. That I think today we've become better politicians, Democrats and Republicans, than we have Catholics. I think we think more with our Democratic or Republican Party than we do with Jesus Christ and his church. And that's to our condemnation. We're not conformed to the truth of the gospel, to the truth of his church. And all of us are called to that. And you can go, oh, this guy's intense, right? And write me off, because that's your understanding is good enough. He can't tell me what to believe or what to do. But the reality is the world is telling you what to believe and what to do. The world's constantly saying you should think this way, you should act this way, you should do these things, right? The pressure of whether or not we have to wear a mask, whether or not we have to do this, whether or not we can do this, right? Who we can hire and fire, more and more pressure is being put on the church, right? These kinds of things are being pressured upon us. I heard a journalist call it a soft tyranny, right? Where they present it as if it's for your good. It's for your good if you do this. It's for your good if you do that. And some of it is. That's where we need the wisdom of Solomon, to discern what is good and what is evil, what is right and what is wrong. We have to be Catholics who are discerning with the heart of Jesus and what he's calling us to, how he's calling us to live in this world. But I can see you're all distracted and not paying attention, so I must be talking too theoretically, huh? We have to be ready. The world is not going to support the Catholic faith, right? Maybe some of you will see the end of your days before the church is in deep struggle. So I'll just say it plainly. I believe the church will be persecuted in my lifetime in this country. I believe that we are going in a way that we will not be able to live in freedom what we believe in truth, revealed by God in His church. And if we don't start to say, how am I called to live in this world, in truth and in freedom and in love, and learn to balance it more and more and continue to conform ourselves to it so that we know who we can rely on and what we're called to do when difficult circumstances continue to arise. Call me this, call me that. It's fine, I'll take it. But I really believe that we have to continually sell everything for Jesus Christ and not continue to buy into ideologies, pressures, and continue to stand against those things, right? Now, I'm not talking about a mask. I don't care. That's not a moral issue. I'm talking about the freedom to worship God and to love Him in everything I do and say, and to stand for what I believe in out there. That's what it means to be a Catholic, to express my faith. Those are the ongoing conversations we need to have as Catholic Christians in the world. We need to continue to conform ourselves to the truth and love of Jesus Christ and hold those things up for the world to see that we stand for Him. And we want others to know and to be invited to know that God is alive and He's working through these circumstances for a greater good. And if we conform ourselves to that good, to His love, we will be transformed to live in His love and mercy in the world. Tonight we pray for the grace to be encouraged of heart, that we might have the courage to give everything, to trust Him with everything, and to love Him with everything. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God and His grace for our lives, we entrust these, our prayers of petition, to Him.
Please respond, Lord, hear our prayer. For the church, that we may place a supreme value on seeking the reign of God and utilize all of our talents to deepen our relationship with God, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. That world leaders will have the wisdom to see the greatest treasure is human life itself and may work to protect and enhance that gift, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For all who are working to defeat the coronavirus, that God will give strength to all healthcare workers, insight to those researching treatments and cures, and patience to all who face daily challenges because of the disease, we pray. For an end to violence in our cities and neighborhoods, that God will touch hearts so that all will value the dignity of each person and seek peace and justice, we pray. For the sick, homebound and those on our prayer lists, that the Holy Spirit may restore them to the fullness of life and health, we pray. That we might grow in wisdom and understanding and use these gifts to continue building up the kingdom of God, we pray. For those who have died, especially Rosie Meester and David Dwayne Sikorsky, whom we remember at Mass this weekend, we pray.
Gracious Father, encourage our hearts to live for you and for your kingdom. Help us to love you and to serve you both in truth and in action, that we could continue to know what you're calling us to do in these times and to serve you with our generous hearts. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. By the mystery of this water and wine, we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. With humble spirit and contrite heart, may we be accepted by you, O Lord, and may our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. Wash me, O Lord, from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the offerings which we bring from the abundance of your gifts, that through the powerful working of your grace, these most sacred mysteries may sanctify our present way of life and lead us to eternal gladness through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you so loved the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we had lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as an exaltation we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and from the world's beginning are ceaselessly at work so that the human race may become holy, just as you yourself are holy. Look, we pray, upon your people's offerings and pour out on them the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, in whom we too are your sons and daughters. Indeed, though we once were lost and could not approach you, you loved us with the greatest love. For your Son, who alone is just, handed himself over to death and did not disdain to be nailed for our sake to the wood of the cross. But before his arms were outstretched between heaven and earth to become the lasting sign of your covenant, he desired to celebrate the Passover with his disciples. As he ate with them, he took bread. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, knowing that he was about to reconcile all things in himself through his blood to be shed on the cross, he took the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, and once more, giving you thanks, handed the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Passover and our surest peace, we celebrate his death and resurrection from the dead, and looking forward to his blessed coming, we offer you, who are our faithful and merciful God, this sacrificial victim who reconciles to you the human race. Look kindly, most compassionate Father, on those you unite to yourself by the sacrifice of your Son, and grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, as they partake of this one bread and one chalice, they may be gathered into one body in Christ, who heals every division. Be pleased to keep us always in communion of mind and heart, together with Francis our Pope and John our Bishop. Help us to work together for the coming of your kingdom, until the hour when we stand before you, saints among the saints in the halls of heaven, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles and all the saints, and with our deceased brothers and sisters, whom we humbly commend to your mercy. Then, freed at last from the wound of corruption and made fully into a new creation, we shall sing to you with gladness the thanksgiving of Christ, who lives for all eternity.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, 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 amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of Christ keep me safe for eternal life.
Peaceful world.
Let us pray. We have consumed, O Lord, this divine sacrament, the perpetual memorial of the passion of your Son. Grant, we pray, that this gift, which he himself gave us with love beyond all telling, may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord. Amen. It's good to be with you this weekend and to celebrate the masses here. I don't have any announcements that were left, but I noticed the mission co-op appeal. There's no speaker. Normally a speaker comes in every year and makes an appeal. That's in the back there with an offering that you can make if you're able for the mission co-op. So the details are there as well. Otherwise, on my part, it's a great joy to be able to let you know that at this time we're planning for seven new seminarians to enter the Diocese of Winona-Rochester this fall, which is a great number. That'll make us our total up to about 20, if it all happens, if they all show up, right? Until the whites of their eyes are in Winona, I don't really count them. But we'll have a new poster for you to pray for them and to continue to ask for your prayers for not only our seminarians, but all those who are discerning. You know, there's a list of like 30 guys that I work with on a semi-regular basis, some obviously more than others, and who are really discerning God's call in their lives. So continue to pray and encourage young people to follow Jesus, and that he is the pearl of great price, the treasure in the field that's worth selling everything for. It is he who is the way, the truth, and the life. So thanks for your prayers and encouragement for vocations. We also have two young women entering religious life that I know of. There could be others. They don't always report into me as the vocations director for the seminarians. But there's at least two that I know of that are entering. One, the Religious Sisters of Mercy from Alma, Michigan. And then also another, I think, was entering a Franciscan community. So we give thanks for that as well. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Salvation.